Good afternoon. Dr. Mohita is, I think her flight is delayed, so she's still on the way. So we will start this very interesting session of presbyopia. I'm Dr. Rohit, Dr. Kamala is there, Dr. Kudlu, Krishna Prasad is here. So let me start with the optics of presbyopia. I'm not going into, we have a very senior group here. I'm not going into the optics, what we learned during our by student time or in your post-graduation, just a little bit different, more of practical optics of presbyopia. These are my financial interests. One of the things about presbyopia, or when you talk about anything to do with the near work, is it's a triad. And that means that your lens accommodates. To accommodate, you also need some amount of convergence, and you also need the pupil to constrict. So many times you blame or you try to look more towards only one aspect of it, okay, the lens. So we always use the word lens and accommodation, but we need the other two. The reason I'm going to bring this concept here is that we need these two also to equally to work well, to get a perfect presbyopic effect, and also to have a very good outcome after any refractive procedures. One of the major issues we had for many years is that we were very old-fashioned in way of looking at accommodation. So we started looking at other tools, new tools to help us to look into the accommodation. So I'll try to bring you two new concepts which helps to understand. They're a little fancy now. They're not so freely available. So over time, and these technologies will become part of your outpatient care when you start doing more and more work on these aspects. So we have something called as a static and it's a dynamic. Most of our understanding of presbyopia is more of static. That means at one stage, okay, you look at an accommodation, at that moment what you get, whether it's, you know, reading glasses or whether whatever you try to look at, understand, so static. But what we are moving towards is more of a dynamic approach. How do you look at the dynamics? There is a tool from, it's an OCT, it's just like your regular OCT, it's nothing different. But it has a accommodation tool. This is from Tomy, it's called Cassia 2, and I'm sure they have a demo unit in the stall here. And this is Osiris, this is just an abrometer, it's just like your eye trace or an OPD3 abrometer. But it has an additional component in it. These are not just only for accommodation. That means if you're buying some tool for your clinic and you want an abrometer or you want an OCT, you can look at one of them because they just have an additional function in it, which probably can help you in your work. So for example, this is a OCT. What is interesting is just the routine OCT, what it does. But this has got a nice feature here. You can induce myopia. So you can see how the lens changes. So you can see the lens changes, so the lens moves forward because you're inducing, say, minus one or minus two. And you can see how the angle changes. So a lot of these things which helps us to understand accommodation at play. And there's one more advantages of this. Osiris is an abrometer, but it has a beautiful software to look at real-time accommodation. This is a dynamic accommodation. This is the stimulus it gives, and now we can see that this is the pupil, how it changes to the accommodation, and then after that the blue line is your real accommodative aspect. You can see it real picture here that the machine actually is taking care of how you are accommodated. This is an accommodation. This is the red thing is when you actually accommodate. So it gives you in real time about how the things are happening. The application of this is many. We'll come to this a little later. So you can see that this is a patient who's accommodating more. This is a pupil, this is a stimulus, this is red is a stimulus. So the patient accommodates more. This is like what in the previous case Dr. Kamal said, my patient ended up with a post-surgery. She comes back after a minus two diopters of myopia again. So that means she's accommodating a lot. Extremely useful in your post-operative status. The second important thing is, we all have assumed that there's one thumb rule. After you turn 40, you accommodate, you need glasses, you need multiple things. But that is not the same. The people can age in your eyes much earlier. For example, This is a patient who still at the age of 40 is still accommodating very well. And the patient at 35 is still at this level. So imagine you try to do a presbyopic surgery on him versus here. Like if I ask Dr. Kudlu, if you do a patient supracor or presbyborn on this patient, he's already accommodating very well. He needs a small pair of glasses. He's just not going to be happy. This is one of the reasons why a lot of our presbyopic laser solutions don't work. It's because we assume that we use a thumb rule. And if you do a laser surgery on this patient, the presbyopic laser surgery on him, he's going to be terribly unhappy. This guy probably needs not plus one, maybe a plus 1.75 as his correction on a presbyopic surgery because his accommodation is completely lost. So any good presbyopic laser surgery, you probably need to understand this concept very well because this is where the challenge comes. And this is a case this is a patient who has very low accommodation, absolutely nil. This is his pupil. And we did a myopic surgery on him. So what do you expect in him? Because most of his near accommodation was managed by his minus power. He never used his accommodation at all. These are unhappy patients because after say one, so this is a pre-op, a 1 week. 1 week, the accommodation is still not doing well. This is a very young patient. And immediately after a month, he starts getting regression of power. This patient comes back and say, my power has come back again. I can't see anything now. You have to recorrect me. So what has really happened in him is he started pseudo-accommodating now. Look at this accommodation now. It's gone beyond. It was zero before surgery because he was a myope. After 1 week, it's still not accommodating, but suddenly he starts pseudo-accommodating. So accommodation is a very important aspect in our life post-surgery, post any refractive surgery, because most of your unhappiness, according to me, 99% of unhappiness just revolves around one of these factors, which we completely ignore in our practice. And this is exactly the same patient. This is his lens, which is accommodating. In here you get the graph, but what you get here is in iTrace is image. And this is a very, very difficult thing to sort out because just giving atropinization doesn't work. You have to give exercises. The patient is always under stress because you can see that it's the patient's refractive error has gone up to minus 5 from 0. He says, you corrected only minus 1. I had minus 1 before surgery. Now it's minus 5. This is because the lens is playing the devil, especially. What happens is the lens and the cornea are synchronized and they work in an accommodation aspect. But when they start, especially in keratoconus, you can see that the lens sometimes even tilts to correct the cylinder. This is something which we did not learn in our books, that we always assume the lens just moves forward and back. It just doesn't bother about anything else. But I'll show you a nice real-time image of this. You can see that now this is accommodation is starting. Now you just see this is the lens which is actually mirroring the corneal topography. That means that this patient is actually seeing very well without any contact lens. We always get this with keratoconus patients coming to you and say that I'm seeing very well with glasses. And we say we have that notion in our mind that keratoconus patients will not see well with the glasses. We say that no, you need contact lenses because you are not supposed to see well because there's something else. But this is the answer. When you have a very beautiful synchrony between the lens and the cornea, 99% of the keratoconus patients who see very well, they're seeing very well because of this particular image because the lens is already helping them. Now, if you use an Intax, or you do a laser, or you do anything on this cornea on this patient, that balance goes off. Then there is a divorce between the two. Then what you see is, then he starts complaining. Then he says that I used to see before surgery very well. Now you made me worse. But your topography looks perfect, but I'm not seeing well because the lens is no longer his friendly to him. That is where the accommodation is very important. Then coming to the convergence. I explained one part of it because for me that's the most important thing. This is again the same patient who comes back after refractive surgery, and he complains that he's got blurred. And you can see that this, all the internal astigmatism is creating this issue. So I just skip this. It shows about the, now the issue is, then these are the people who are a little stressed about the outcomes. The neurological, psychological, and the oculomotor, all of them starts playing the devil. So the near reflex is a triad of all three. So if the if you have a convergence excess or fusional issues, the pupil also will start reacting and the lens will also start reacting. So what happens is then these kind of a picture emerges. So a lot of these people, along with this is how it looks office-based or home-based therapies. And this is because if you don't give them therapies and you just concentrate on the cornea, nothing will go off. Earlier, we used to do one mistake, is just atropinize them and say that, and relax the lenses. That doesn't work, because if you atropinize them, your the binocular muscular movements are still odd as before, and that's what really creates a mess. The finally, in presbyopia, it's just not having a clear lens at 50. It's all about having how your lens densitometry is changing. Enough talk now on about the dysfunctional lens syndrome, and we can see that these lenses have already started getting aged, even though the cornea looks good. So that means that you don't need to wait for them to completely show a color change. Color change is probably the thing of past. When you see somebody not happy with the vision and you feel you can't sort them out and you feel that there is an internal aberration, you probably can go ahead and treat them off. These are all machines which can help you in trying to diagnose. So understanding optics is probably the most important thing if you want to get into anything to do with presbyopia today. It's just not the internal optics, it's also about the ocular movements, the convergence, the fusional divergence, excess, and everything related to that is probably the key for presbyopia management. Thank you. Any questions? Oh, you are here. So how many patients you feel that in your clinic you feel improve only with atropine with pseudo-accommodative spasm? Yeah, because you are a pediatric ophthalmologist, neuro. She's a pediatric ophthalmologist, neurologist.
Atropine is not always the answer, because the moment you give them atropine, you paralyze their accommodation for almost 21 days, and most of them then come back complaining that they're not able to see the near very clearly. Then you start giving them glasses for that.
I have a question for you. If you have a convergence excess, and that is actually leading to a pseudo-accommodative spasms, then just atropinization may not work, right?
Yeah. So like it's you said, orthoptic exercises, convergence exercises at home, those help.
Thank you. My take-home point is anything on the cornea or anything on the lens in your lens for a presbyopic patients, please look at the orthoptics also along with your all other tests what you're doing, because for me the last 1 year most of the unhappiness actually stems from there. Thank you. Dr. Moita is also here now.
After a wonderful talk from Rohit, I think a lot to learn, so many things. I think you have to be really careful whenever you are treating a presbyopic patient. So I'll be talking about Presbyon, my 3 year experience. This is my financial disclosure. I'm consultant to Carl Zeiss India. So as you are telling, there are different principles to correct presbyopia. Still most of our friends are doing one eye for distance and other eye for near, something called monovision treatment. Or even you can do multifocality, you can do it in the cornea also, multifocal cornea. Or you can even plan for increased depth of focus, what we do it in Cambrai inlays by treating one eye for distance and other eye for near vision. Or even you can opt for combined approaches. So what exactly this Presbyon laser blended vision? It's a combination of micro mono vision with increased depth of focus by using Excimer system, either MEL 80 or MEL 90 from Carl Zeiss Meditech, with a special software system called CRS Master. So these are the 9-in-1 principle, monovision principle, depth of field to reduce anisometropia, spherical aberration control, vertex centration of spherical aberration, then followed by retinal image processing, in the end, neural summation, blur adaptation, and neural separation. So what exactly we do here, we make the dominant eye emmetropic, make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopter. So what is this blend zone? Blend zone is the zone where images from both from dominant and the non-dominant eye meets up and binocularity retains. So what exactly we do here, as I already said that we make the dominant eye emmetropic, also make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopter. But how we increase the depth of focus? It is by creating a controlled spherical aberration in both the corneas. So by not only making the dominant eye and non-dominant eye myopic, by creating a spherical aberration only, then you will only have the depth of focus. So why we are not opted for multifocal treatment? Because brain tend to get each eye different image at the same time, images from distance vision and images from near vision, it takes a lot of time to adapt. And a few of my friends, I think almost 5 to 8 years before, they used to do this multifocal cornea treatment. So always the patient used to come to us also, they used to have a blurred vision, blurred distance vision. And also the most of 99% of the patient has come to my friend, what they used to tell that there is definitely a loss of one line as far as the distance vision is concerned. And most of the patient took almost 3 months to get adjust. And after 5 to 6 years, you have to repeat the treatment. So of course, multifocal IOLs, I think we have been doing, as Rohit was telling, like if the lens is problematic, definitely you need to think about multifocal intraocular lens. But when you're opting for either multifocal or trifocal lens, you have to talk with the patient, you have to counsel them mainly about night driving problem, halos and glare. Some of the patient, definitely they become irritated, and a few of my friends still I been talking to me, they have done even explantation of the intraocular lens. So the problems of multifocal IOLs also you need to understand, and the counseling of the patient is also very, very important. So why we pick this micromonovision? See, you have seen in children with amblyopia, brain tend to suppress certain blur from one eye to the other eye. So it get adjusted very fast. So basically this laser blended vision treatment is a bilateral treatment. You have to treat both the eyes. Always binocular vision will be sharper than the monocular vision. So 97% in my all case studies, 97% of all my patients are tolerate this patient, and there is no cross blur. So as I said, you have to treat the both the eye. Even the patient is asking for one eye treatment, normally I tend to treat both the eyes together. So now coming to the marketing aspect, I think this is the one market I think nobody has been touched. There is lot of scope is there in presbyopia. Normally we never, what we do in our practice, when the patient go to a refraction room, refraction is just do the refraction, then they send it to the doctor, then doctor tend to give them the glasses. But if you tell them, if you see, okay, one day around 100 patient, if you give them around 20 to 30 patient, at least 2 to 3 patient, definitely they convince for this treatment. But provided all your preoperative evaluation has to be ultimate. So normally in our case series, most of the LASIK patient, their parents, they come to us, they come and ask, do you have any other option? I also don't want to wear the glasses. These are the patient, even we counsel them also. Even we have done, like last month also I had done one of the pseudophakic patient, very unhappy. He was myopic before, and he was telling like, I don't want to see far at all, but do something for my near vision. After 3 months of cataract surgery done elsewhere, we have done press beyond on pseudophakic patient. Patients are doing really well. So as you said that, because the greatest advantage of this treatment, all my patients has a very good intermediate vision. So where you really require intermediate vision, especially the nowadays most of them with the computer users, they really doesn't want to wear the glasses. Otherwise, if you give them the glasses, if you give them a bifocal, they tend to go near and they keep coming to you with the doctor, please change my glasses. So there are a lot of market is there, and especially in this particular treatment. See, these are the patients, actually 300 consecutive patients had come to us for 3 years follow-up. The mean age is between 39 to 55 years. And most of our case series, we have treated around 145 patients myopic with myopic astigmatism, 75 patient hypermetropic patient, and even we treated around 30 patient with emmetropia. So this is our power range, myopia minus 0.25 to minus 7.25 diopters, hypermetropia 0.25 to 4 diopters, astigmatism up to 2.75 diopters. So target refraction, always we targeted for plano for distance eye, and between minus 1.25 to 1.75 near eye, based on the age and micromonovision acceptance. Even my case series, as I already showed that from 37 years. So younger patient, I normally put it 1.25. The patient is more than 50, 52 years, I normally increase up to 1.75. So 1.75 along with some spherical aberration, around 0.37 to 0.55. The exact spherical aberration, we really don't know how much it induces. That gives you almost an effect of around 2.25 to 2.5 near vision add. So you need not have to repeat this treatment. So this is my standard protocol, how you do your LASIK treatment. So follow up day one, first week, 1 month, 3rd month, 6 month, 12 months, and 24 months. So 3 years follow up, I'm having the patients. And who can undergo this treatment? Any person in presbyopic age, provided there should not have any cataractous changes. And even myopia, we have done up to even 8 diopter, depending upon the PACI value. Hypermetropia, we have stretched up to 4.5 diopters. Emmetropia, you can do. Even patient with astigmatism, around 2.5 to 3 diopters, you can do this treatment. Up to the, coming to the technique, main thing, refraction is very, very important. Irrespective patient is myopic or hypermetropic, I do cycloplegic refraction for all these patients undergoing treatment. Even though there are lots of optometrists working in my hospital, this particular dominance eye testing is done by me only, because you tend, if you miss there by selecting the dominant eye testing, then you are messed with the treatment. So this particular, I think, test you have to do. Once you know that which is the dominant eye, suppose my dominant eye is right eye, then my left eye is a non-dominant eye, that eye you have to do micromonovision testing by putting plus 1.5 diopters for near vision. Tell him to read for near vision. With the same correction on, you tell him to read for distance. If these patients can, with the non-dominant eye addition of 1.5, can able to read even 6.6 for distance and N5 for near, these are the patients really do well. There are certain percent of the patient, once you put this for non-dominant eye, they start telling that I'm having cross blur. This patient you have to repeat 2 to 3 times. Still patients start telling that, doctor, something has put in front of my eyes, I cannot tolerate. These are the patients you should never pick them for this particular treatment. As Dr. Rohit was telling, I think we need to evaluate more and more in the different aspect. I think this machine, I still remember one of my patient I operated, and the patient was very unhappy for distance vision. Then I took for second opinion to Rohit. Rohit did in the particular that NIDAC machine, then he could able to diagnose that she is having a accommodative spasm. So you have to, do more and more tests. Treating presbyopia is very easy, but pre-op evaluation is very, very important. Once if you are through with that, okay, this patient really do preoperatively, then the same data can be entered into the CRS master, then with the same pen flash drive, you can take into the Mel 80 or Mel 90, whatever the examiner system, then go ahead with the treatment. So you need not have to change any of the protocol there, but now they have come with the new software. You can change the overall, you can add the functional age also, and you can do the, even you can change the optical zone also. So I'll not go into the video, similar to how you do the LASIK treatment. So these are the my results for 36 months. As I said, that binocular vision will be more sharper than the monocular vision. But one main thing in our study, what we found, none of the eyes lost more than half Snellen's line of vision when compared to pre-op corrected distance visual acuity. So none of the patient actually really lost any of the distance vision, they're very happy. So majority of the patient actually retain their functional stereo acuity and no loss of contrast sensitivity. So this is about the results. Achieved spherical equivalent correction was within 0.5 diopters in 92% of the cases, within minus 1 diopter in 100% of the year, even at 1 year also. Monocular uncorrected distance visual acuity 6.6 at least 70%, 6/9 at least in 98%. Binocularity 80% red 6.6 and 100% red 6/9. Binocular uncorrected vision for near vision, N8 in NIT in 3% of the cases, but 97% of the patient read N6. All patients had a satisfactory intermediate vision also, and the higher number of the patient read 6-6 binocularly when compared when seeing through the only dominant eye. And these are the advantages, as I said, that wide range of power you can do. The greatest advantage with this treatment, which is not depend upon the pupil size. And all my patients had a very good intermediate vision and near vision. I think different treatment people will be talking. Mohita has got a very good experience with SupraCore. I think Dr. Rohit Shetty has done a lot of presbyelastic. Each, once again, all depend upon how is your pre-op workup, how is your grip with your the treatment, what particular treatment you are doing. If you are doing really well with the SupraCore, go ahead with that particular treatment. Definitely patient will be happy. Once again, pre-op evaluation and overall workup of the patient give you the more satisfied. But I am very happy. I personally feel that Presbyand is one of the best presbyopic treatment available in the world. Thank you so much for the kind here.
Good afternoon to you all. So Dr. Kudlu has just talked about Presbyond. I'll be talking about another modality of presbyelasic, since here we are talking about all different types of treatments of presbyopia. Now this modality is called SupraCore, and we have been talking about it for the last 3 years, so I'll give a little bit of more extra points today. This is again an excimer treatment which corrects for far, intermediate, and distance vision. And this can be either a unilateral treatment or a bilateral treatment depending upon how the patient is accepting it. As Dr. Kudlu just said, all this we decide based on a pre-op assessment, which is the most important. And this is done using the Bausch-Lomb Tineo machine. The basic principle is that there is a central 3 millimeter bump which is created. And this 3 millimeter bump is responsible for the near vision, and from 3 to 6 millimeters we have a distance zone, and in between them we have a intermediate zone. Now these are the SupraCore bumps, and again this is showing the same thing where you can see the central steepening, which is because of the central bump of SupraCore that we have done. And again the principle becomes that when we read, then the pupil constricts and the light primarily passes through the central cornea. And when we are viewing for distance, then the pupil dilates, and it's the 3 to 6 millimeters which becomes more active. The flip side is that there is always a slight impact on the distance vision, because when the person is viewing for distance, then through the central 3 millimeters also some rays are passing, which are responsible for a slight 1 or 2 line impact on distance vision. Hence the pre-op assessment as to whether the patient is adjusting to this type of vision or not, and whether we have to do a unilateral or a bilateral treatment becomes important. Then similarly, when the pupil is small, for example, somebody goes out in the sunlight, then there may be a impact on the distance vision. Two important things about this are that this is a micro monovision. It's not a monovision. There's a difference of only 0.25 to 0.5. Hence, there's a better depth of perception compared to any micro monovision. Secondly, it has been often said to be a multifocal profile, and hence things like glare and halos have become worrisome, and these have been concerns. But in our patients, which is around 200 patients done till now, we have not seen any patient complain of glare or halos. This could probably because this is just a single step, which is different from a multifocal lens where you have multiple steps. Now, since there are 1 or 2 line distance loss, which is there always in whenever we do a SupraCore treatment, as I said, this could be because of the rays that are also passing through the central 3 millimeters, but this could also, there have been concerns that is this treatment inducing any higher order aberrations. Now, when we went through the literature, we found that there were reports of 1 or 2 line loss, which was happening in 6.5% to 28% of patients who underwent any presbyelasic treatment, including Presbymax. And in our experience, we found this two line loss to be 7%. So we decided to look into the aberrations of a of those patients, small number of patients for which we have had the follow-ups as a retrospective study, and we found that at 1 month there is an increase in vertical coma. It becomes from negative, it goes to positive vertical trefoil, and there is a significant change in the spherical aberrations from positive to negative. But at 3 months, we found that this thing was stabilizing. The only thing that was remaining significantly increased was spherical aberrations. And this probably was of benefit, because whenever there are these spherical aberrations, then this helps in the depth of vision. So this may be actually helping out in the near vision. This SupraCore is basically a wavefront optimized or a ProScan treatment. It is not a wavefront customized treatment. So it is obvious that it must be inducing aberrations. But what we found was that it is inducing aberrations at 1 month, but there is a stabilizing effect which happens from 3 months onwards. And no significant difference was found when we compared this to other LASIK-treated eyes. There is a central corneal steepening, which obviously would induce a negative spherical aberration, and this is what will help in the depth of focus. And in similarly, like in Press Beyond also, this we are playing with the spherical aberrations. So this is the same thing which is happening here also. And when we compared SupraCore-treated eyes with hyperopic LASIK-treated eyes, we found more negative spherical aberrations in SupraCore-treated eyes, which means that this was not just the LASIK effect, it was an effect of central corneal steepening also. And similar things have been found in literature also. And this is what we found for uncorrected distance visual acuity. We found that binocularly, all our patients were 6x6, though uniocular, they were not. Similarly, for near vision also, binocularly, all of them were N6. So this treatment we have been doing in hyperopes, myopes, as well as emmetropic patients. We always counsel the patient that this is a measure. We select patients between 40 to 55 years of age, and we always counsel the patient that this is a temporary measure for, say, around 10 years or so, because the maximum that it corrects is up to 1.75 to 2 diopters. But when they are above that power, which means that somewhere around 60 years of age, if they have a power of 3, then also we would have corrected up to 2, so the patient would have just a power of 1. So the dependence would be less. This is what we counsel them. So it's basically a trade-off between the near and distance vision, and this has to be explained to the patient. So in hyperopia, we do a bilateral treatment approach, which means that in the dominant eye, we do a mild or a soft SupraCore where we correct up to 1.25 to 1.5 diopters, whereas in the non-dominant eye, we do a regular SupraCore, which means that we correct up to plus 2. So the dominant we make better for distance, and the non-dominant we make better for near. In myopia, we can do either a monolateral or a bilateral treatment approach, but generally we are doing a monolateral treatment approach, which again means that in the non-dominant eye, we do a regular SupraCore and correct up to plus 2, and in the dominant eye, we just do a LASIK to correct the myopia. For all deciding on all this, we have to do a preoperative simulation test. As Dr. Kudlu said, this is very important, that we put our 0.5 diopters in front of the patient's best corrected visual acuity and for distance. And we show to the patient that this is what you would see. And if the patient says, I'm not comfortable with this vision, that means this patient is not for SupraCore, because there will be some line loss in SupraCore treatment. And similarly for near, we put 1.75 in the non-dominant eye and 1.25 in front of the dominant eye. And we show to the patient that this is what you will see. And if the patient says that the patient is comfortable, then only we carry out this procedure. So this selection becomes important. Just showing some few typical cases, this is a hypermetropic patient with a plus 1 diopters for distance and 1.75 for near. In this, we did in the right, which was the dominant eye, we did a soft SupraCore, and in the left, which was non-dominant, we did a regular SupraCore. So the right eye became better for distance with the 6/6 parts vision, and the left eye became better for near with an N6 vision. And binocular was 6/6 parts and N6. Then second case, a myope with a plus 2 addition. Now since this is a myope, we did a regular SupraCore in the non-dominant eye and a soft SupraCore in the dominant eye. And again, we got a desired result of 6/6 parts and N6. But another patient who's a hypermetrope with a plus 1.5 for near. And in this patient, when we did a simulation, just as I just talked about it, we found that the patient was not happy for distance. So in this patient, in the right eye, which was the dominant eye, we just did a LASIK, and in the despite the patient being a hypermetrope, and in the left eye which was non-dominant, we did a regular supracor. So basically what I mean to say is that we have to decide case to case, on a case to case basis, depending upon what the results of our simulation test are. And this is a subjective questionnaire, because it's ultimately it's a case selection and how the patient feels, which helps us in deciding whether or not we do the procedure. The first question asked in this questionnaire was, what can you read without glasses? The patient's response was that after supracor, they could read, before supracor they could read headlines, but after that they could read menu cards, short messages, newspapers, package inserts. So basically the dependence from glasses was not there. Are you comfortable in front of working in front of the PC? 50% said they were not very comfortable, and 50% said they were very comfortable. In other words, there may be some dependence on glasses. And third, how is your night vision compared to pre-op? The answer was, it was worse only in 4% of cases, but it was better or same in rest of the 96% of cases. And lastly, would you recommend this surgery to your friends? The answer was, in 96% cases, again, the answer was yes. So it is a promising presbylasic ablation profile. It has been there for last 3 years. In fact, we have more and more presbylasic treatments coming up in the newer, newer technologies in our LASIK machines. And the concern of higher order aberrations I've talked about, and this becomes important because when we compare it with other presbylasic options, we find that this is not much of a concern in this case. Thank you. We have done it for patients who are emetropes also, and the youngest age was 38 years of age, and was a patient with a plus one of power and emetropic, and the patient was counseled extensively, but the patient was satisfied in the post-op period. Yes, we started with pseudophakic patients where we corrected up to 1.75 power, and so patient was left with 1.25 diopters. These were the initial patients that we did, and these patients were also happy. And there was one patient who wanted a multifocal in one eye, so we did put a multifocal lens in that eye, and in the other eye we did a supracor, and this was also this kind of satisfied patient.
I guess presbyopia is a very intriguing topic. First, we get Dr. Rohit Shetty, who's a master magician with technology and research work. He'll end up spinning the dishes for you, and then each speaker will come and share their experiences. And probably they do what they believe in is best. So in given situations, what would be my ace card is what I'll be discussing here. I'll be talking about presbyopic phakic IOLs, which is probably not the new kid in the block, but probably more so new kid in the block, because either most people are not doing it, or if they are doing it, not many people know about it. So I'll be sharing my experiences with that. Let's start. All of us, including me, are getting presbyopic. The biggest joke is my son was trying to install a video game in the laptop, and he wanted to read the serial number, and he was punching the keyboard. He says, Papa, number padho. I said, I couldn't. So he told me, I think you need to show a good eye surgeon. So my son, when he said that to me, I realized what presbyopia means. See, as we age, accommodation declines, but our expectations don't. We still feel young, but our eyes don't match up with us. So I actually feel presbyopia in ophthalmology is the holy grail. And is presbyopic IPCL the missing link? Let's see. The best part about presbyopic IPCL is it's a reversible procedure. Can we reverse the relax or clearance extraction, we cannot. Presbyopic, LASIK, yes, maybe, maybe not. But this is one technology which I feel you can actually reverse for the patient. It all started with the phakic lenses, which have probably started from the anterior chamber. Then there came the posterior iris-supported lenses, and then the lens-supported lenses. So let's talk about lens-supported lenses. These lenses have been there for a very long time. Nearly more than 5 lakh lenses have been implanted all over the world. More than 20 years of track record proven, and it's a biocompatible acrylic material. Newer designs, newer materials, newer technologies are coming in. The lenses are getting thinner and thinner. The last lens I used was 80 microns thin. So the audience can actually imagine what is an 80 micron lens. So I'm using 80 micron lenses in my daily life. So when you do a prelex, are we ending up cutting something which we can save? I think so, we can save that. Especially when you do the prelex, you need to do the keratometry, the axial length, the formulas, the centration, the PCO management. That all is avoided when you do a phakic implant. All you need is a refraction, acceptance, anterior chamber depth, and white to white. So accuracy of prediction of IOL powers, suppose you want to do a progressive correction in a patient who's a high myope, IOL formulas become an issue, availability of the IOL power in PC IOL power in that patient is an issue. What are the advantages of doing a presbyopic IPCL? You retain the elasticity of the lens. That's what Dr. Rohit Shetty says. The lens is far more than a simple tissue which is focusing. It is an elastic tissue. Even I'm 49, 50 now, I can still read in good light. So why should I lose that if I go in for a prelex? Faster recovery because you've not cut the tissues open, you've done a capsular access. Size and power, any extreme is available in a progressive IPCL. You can go from 0.5 to minus 30, different sizes, toricities, it corrects your refraction, it corrects your astigmatism, and of course, it corrects your presbyopia. Now let's see some numbers which actually made me move towards this technology. I've actually done nearly 1,300 plus IPCLs. Over 900 were the V1 model, which was the earlier model. V2 model I've started using lately. I've fallen in love with this design. I've been using these lenses for over 4-5 years now. We've done 17 cases of piggyback for post-pseudophakic refractive error. That's when the idea came into me and I talked to the company that we can have something like this. I had patients who were operated by some other surgeon, minus 5, minus 6, 2 years, 3 years old, capsular fibrosis. Now do I explant? Do I do a LASIK? So I started putting IPCL in those patients. And these patients have started doing very well. So that's where the idea came of started doing, how about putting a multifocal presbyopic lens? Now 17 cases we've done of presbyopic IPCLs, 11 are secondary piggyback and 6 are primary. Now what are the issues I've faced in these 1,300 approximate cases? We explanted 4 cases. One was post-traumatic. The gentleman got injured while playing and he had a cataract. The lens needed to be explanted. The other 3 explants were not due to the lens, but it was bad sizing. Believe me, the lens will always bad vault. I call the word bad vault when your measurements are wrong. Once you get your measurements tight, this works like a beauty. No explants till now for halos or glare. No refractive surprises till date. We've never explanted a lens for a refractive surprise or a halo. We've only explanted due to rotation of the lenses or an excessive vault or crowding of the lens. The mainstay is if you can do your white to white accurately, anterior chamber depth and pupil size, you're ready to go. And you need a good refraction. So the advantage is you don't need an expensive equipment like a LASIK. So then we had good experience with the technology of multifocus from this company. The huge track record of nearly 4,000 lenses used till now. We've used trifocals, we've used toric multifocals, toric trifocals. The list goes on and on. So I realized that this was a good combination. So I've used an IPCL and I've used a progressive or a multifocal lens or a trifocal lens on the same platform. So how about joining these two? That's when the idea came of started using progressive lenses. So did we have any issues with the multifocal lenses? There were no decentrations. Yes, PCOs were there, negligible glare and halos, available in smart toric, which means you didn't need to dilate them. And then of course the trifocal lenses are available, which is the new kid on the block.
This is a photograph of the toric. You can see the PCO, but you see that the centration. The best part of these lenses is you have to just center them at 0-180. Even if there's astigmatism, you center them at 0-180. So you don't need to dial them. That's a big plus point. So much so, even my femto cases, I've started using these lenses with toricity or non-toricity. Now coming to the presbyopic IPCL. Now what is confluence? There's a confluence of a multifocal or a trifocal technology, toricity, and a phakic lens, all joining together to form the presbyopic IPCL. What are the contraindications? Of course, if your patient has lenticular changes, he's in an age group where he's getting cataract, even a peripheral cataract, he's not a candidate because very soon you'll be doing a cataract. So go ahead and do a clear lens extraction in him. Convergence issue, as Dr. Rohit said, if the patient has some convergence issues, avoid them. Very large pupils, avoid them. Pupils which don't dilate properly, avoid them because putting in the phakic lens will be tricky. Anterior chamber depth less than 2.8 millimeters, history of recurrent uveitis, macular pathologies, corneal abnormalities. Cycloplegic refraction is very important when you're planning to do a progressive phakic lens. Anterior chamber depth is the cornerstone. Two important things if you have to master when you're doing a progressive phakic lens or a phakic lens is an accurate anterior chamber depth measurement and an accurate wide to wide. I have a special session on this, but I don't think the topic will be able to cover that. But what I would recommend is take the mid limbus. Take the mid limbus, don't go at the edge. It's a bad idea to use an infrared image. And if you use an infrared image, never take the machine's reading. Zoom on the image and do a manual correction. So this is what I mean by the mid limbus. You can use an ob scan, Sirius, Pentacam, or a UBM, but the values will be different. A UBM will give you a bigger white to white. A Pentacam is known to give you a more white to white than actual by 0.38. So nearly you will get a 0.4 bigger. I'm very happy doing it on a Sirius and a Pentacam. Or I use a caliper also. All you need to do is get your white to white, add 0.75 to it, and that's the size of the IPCL you should be ordering. If your AC depth is more than 3.1, order 1 millimeter on top. So let's say if your white to white is 12 millimeter, AC depth is 3 millimeter, order a 13 millimeter. But suppose your AC depth is more than 3.2, you can go by 1.25 more. That gives you a very good vault. Again, no high-end surgical equipment is required. You don't need LASIK machines. You don't need high-end equipment for that. Now, presbyopic IPCLs are available in 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5. One of my first patients was my OT technician. I'll share the story. Now, they are available in powers of 0.5, which means if you have a patient who's 50 years old and is minus 6, you can correct his minus 6, and you can also correct his presbyopia in one go, and this procedure is totally reversible. Another thing you can do is, let's say his patient is minus 6 with minus 2 cylinder. You correct his cylinder, you correct his spherical error, and you correct his presbyopia. So you will have combinations available, different sizes according to the wide to wide and pupil sizes available. Patients like selection criteria, this is recommended by the company. I do my own tweakings sometimes in between. I usually go for a unilateral implant and I let the patient be for some time. I don't rush into it. Earlier, first few cases I was rushing into it. I let the patient use it in a non-dominant eye. I give an add of 0.3 more than the patient requires. Let's say the patient requires 1.5 add, I put a 2 diopter lens. What that does for the patient is it gives him an extra depth. He starts relaxing his accommodation, whatever he has, so that goes back to the reserve. And then he has an extended period. I give him 2-3 weeks. If he's happy, he doesn't complain of any other issues, the vaulting is fine, everything is fine, then I go ahead and put in the bilateral. But if the patient says, I'm very happy with one eye, I'm actually doing work and I don't think I need the second eye, we just do one eye and let the patient go. Now, what are the tests you need to do? Gonioscopy is very, very important to check the angle crowding. Do an anterior segment OCT to see the iris insertion patterns. 6-6, if both eyes are there, use the non-dominant eye first. And one thing I've realized is it works best in pseudophakic patients. And just imagine what has happened is all the patients whom you have done cataract for, it was like an account closed for you. Both eyes operated, account closed. Checkbook torn, passbook torn. Now you have another credit card. Now you can offer these patients presbyopic correction. Irrespective whether they have a distance refraction or not, you can start offering them. So I've started doing that now. Most of my patients are in this category now. Patients who've got met somebody where I've done a multifocal primary implant, but I've operated them 5 years ago with a monofocal. And they say, Doc Saab, mera hi ho sakta hai. I say, ho sakta hai, we'll do some tests for you. We do it one eye. If he's happy, don't do the other eye. But if he's, he says, Doc Saab, I want the same in other. So we do it at the other eye also. So it works beautifully. There's a patent filed on this in USA. This, I'll just show a video of, this was the first implant I tried in an amblyopic patient. I didn't want to take risk. So this is an implant in a, this was a patient who was amblyopic. So there were no big issues. I just took my chance. I said, let's see how he does. The patient's best corrected vision was 618, 612 parts. We did the lens. We corrected plus 6 and gave him a plus 1.5 add. And the patient was happy. So that actually encouraged me. Then the next patient I did was my OT technician. I did my OT technician in a live surgery in DOS. So how, what the problem was, he started, I had operated cataract for him 5 years ago. And he used to fumble at times trying to bend my capsular access needle or trying to load the lens. So he's a very old OT technician in the OT. So one day he said, sir, aap live surgery mein logon ka karte ho, ye agar aap achha lens hai, mere ko daloge. I said, okay, I'll do one eye. So one eye I did in the live surgery. And 3 days post that, he started assisting me in the OT again. And he said, sir, I can see, but it'll be good idea if you do the second one. So once I did the second eye, and his assisting me really improved. That gave me courage that if my OT technician who needs to do fine work is feeling better, so I started offering the secondary piggyback in my pseudophakic patients as an open thing. So when a patient, old patient walks in for a review for some other problem, my counselor tells them, sir, we have a technology, if you want, we can offer you. Some of them say, okay, we'll take time. They take back the brochure, they go back, sometime they come back. So now we've started doing that. This is the first patient we did. So it's a proprietary design, advantage over Prelex, which I did say, predictability of correcting the refractions, the risks of doing open surgery with taking the cataract out, the PC rent, and the other chances of, you know, having tear extension. Suppose you plan a multifocal lens, a simple lens in this patient, and the rexis gets torn out. You're stuck up. You've taken the lens, crystalline lens out, and you cannot put the regular lens, multifocal in. Now what do you do? So these are situations you can land up with Prelex. Extreme powers are available till minus 29. So this is the summary. There are innumerable papers coming in the market, and people are, peer literature are reporting about it. So most of the people are happy. Okay. So thank you.
Dr. Kamal, just one question. How do you compare it with piggyback IOLs? How you compare with the Sulcoflex or?
Sir, for Sulcoflex, you need to have a good anterior chamber depth. Okay. I've done 7 or 8 Sulcoflex lenses. The advantage with this lens is, sir, since it's a linear vault, if you know the design, the lens lands like a flat plate and it slowly rises and only rises up in the pupillary zone. Whereas the Sulcoflex is approximately 340 to 300 micron thick lens. It needs a good thickness. So if your ACD and angle crowding is bad, that's not the choice. But this, in most of your pseudophakic patients, most of them, most of your pseudophakic patients, an IPCL progressive lens will go eyes closed, which is not the case with Sulcoflex.
Thank you. Good afternoon. So presbyopia probably is the last frontier in ophthalmology where we are still don't have a perfect solution. Of course, we have got various options, but to a perfection mark, it still is lacking. So we have got various options. We may do corneal procedures like laser. We can do like Cambra inlays, or we can have phakic IOLs, and we can do refractive lens exchange. So I'll be covering multifocal IOLs and EDOF for this purpose. So we have to understand that presbyopia is a progressive problem. It's not a stationary thing. A 40-year-old presbyopic may be different from a 60-year-old presbyopic. So once you are choosing a procedure, you have to be very clear what is the age of patient And as Dr. Rohit has pointed out, you have to look about the lens clarity also. You have to see there is any changes in the lens. If it's getting turning yellow, that means you need to change the lens. That will be better. In early 40s, probably LASIK is a better choice. So coming to the multifocal and extending the depth of IOLs. So all we know, the conventional IOL is a single focus, and near vision is a problem in these cases. The people have tried to do multifocal lenses in various way. It started long back in 1982. But the credit goes to John Pierce in 1986, who was to implant the bull's eye lens or the multifocal IOL. So by definition, single IOL with two or more foci is a multifocal IOL. Most of the IOL we have got now, multifocal so-called, is are bifocal IOLs, but they are again multifocal, right? So the types we have got is the refractive, diffractive, or maybe combination of the both. So the refractive IOLs, it has got two zone lens. There's a concentric rings all around, and annulus type of the lens, bullseye, it's dependent on the pupil. So it has to be very, very well centered. Diffractive multifocal IOLs, these IOLs utilize the principle of diffraction in conjunction with refraction to create two foci. The basic refractive power is provided by the anterior aspheric surface, and the diffractive power comes from the multiple grooves on the posterior surface. It's not a pupil dependent, so even a slight decentration may not cause much problem in diffractive IOL. But refractive IOL has to be very, very well centered. Your axis has to be perfect, everything has to be perfect, otherwise it will cause you a lot of problems. The main limitation of multifocals are the presence of glare, halos, and reduced contrast sensitivity, which is seen to be improved with bilateral implantation. You did one, patient will have complaint. So if you're going to do multifocal lens, try to do within a month of the two lenses. That will give you better accommodation, better adjustment, and a bilateral summation effect will take most of the problems. This is a Technis IOL. We can see there's a modified prolet anterior surface optic that neutralizes the positive aspherical aberration of the human cornea. There's a refractive multifocals. They're good for excellent intermediate and distance vision, while the diffractive multifocals are excellent for reading and very good distance vision. The most recently introduced Acrisoft Restore is the apodized diffractive IOL. The unique feature of Restore lens is that it has apodized diffractive optics. The term apodization derived from the Greek literally meanings cutting the feet off. So there are the sharp points, only the feet are cut off, so that makes apodization of the lens. The concept of apodization means gradual transition of optical properties from the center of lens to the edge. This is the Restore. I'll not go into detail of technical details. So we have got multifocal toric also, which is from 0.5 to 3, now even much more than that. Then what are the preoperative considerations? If we decided to go for multifocal, the patient should have a strong desire to be spectacle independent. If the patient is not desired, don't push it. This is the single most important indication for multifocal lens surgery. Age, by and large, it would be better to operate within 35 to 75 years. After 75, there are some pathologies in the macula and fovea. The patient may not be very happy with the result. Functional occupation required, a detailed history on the point is most crucial. Does the patient have any hobbies like painting, playing, piano? Basically, you have to look for what is the his lifestyle is. What are the things he's going to use? He's going to use more of intermediate vision. He's going to use more of near vision. Or he's a driver who has to drive in the night also. So these things has to be considered. And patient is multitasking or is doing only paperwork. These things matters a lot. And of course, you have to rule out the ocular pathologies like ARMD, glaucoma. And we know that there is a decrease in the contrast sensitivity in these patients. So avoid in diabetic patient also. Patient, if the patient are very hypercritical and demanding, the patient want very perfect vision, they are in a profession like photography or where the very sharp vision, like the bank person who has to work on the lasers, who has to work on the books also, who has to work on the computer, it's better to avoid these patients. And I think the patient who are very cynical and suspecting patients who remains unhappy no matter how best we perform. Such are the patients who will remain more bothered with the halos and mild transient glare, which may be present initially. So there should be strong effort for near reading without glasses. These avid users will be very, very happy with apodized diffractive multifocal lenses, which has very good unaided near vision. So patients who are doing more of reading or close work, a diffractive lens will be better choice. The night drivers, for all these patients, even a short-term glare or halo effect will be intolerable. So you have to do counsel these patients with explaining them about the potential side effects, also the fact that they are easily tolerable with binocular submission and lesson from the time is very crucial. So what are the intraoperative exclusion criteria? If there is a significant vitreous loss, don't try through it. Pupil trauma during surgery, if there is a general damage, if there is a rexus tear, if there is a capsule rupture, avoid in these cases putting a multifocal. A monofocal may be more forgiving in these cases. So what are the keys for successful multifocal IOL implantation? The patient selection should be the most important thing. Second is the accurate biometry. If your results, you are getting good with your optical, you have to use optical biometry, and your results are very good with monofocal, then try using multifocal. And all the readings has to be checked twice. If you don't have an optical biometer, then immersion biometry can be used. So power calculation, maximize visual outcome by calculating a post-op refraction spherical equivalent from planar to 0.25. Use of newer formulas like Hill RBF or Barrett's formula, they are much better. And naturally, we have to have a very good CCC. It should cover the lens optics and removal of all viscoelastic from behind the lens and proper position of the lens in the capsular bag. What are the disadvantages with multifocal? They causes light intensity into the eye is halved. In bull eye lenses, amount of light transmitted to each of focal lens varies with pupil size. Thus, distant and near objects may be of different intensity. In diffractive lens, image intensity is equal for distance and near vision, but even in LD situation, only half the light enters on one focus. Contrast sensitivity is decreased in these cases, so you have to be very careful. Even more light may be lost due to scattering. Thus, patient with multifocal may require brighter light to read well and generally function less well in dim light. Off-axis aberration in decentered IOL may cause more problems in multifocals compared to conventional IOLs. Okay, so where we have to do it, keenly interested in spectacle independence, easygoing personality with positive attitude, would accept small compromise on distance vision, willing to understand that this is not a procedure with guaranteed results. That's very important. And better if little hypermetropic patients. No, where should not use it, does not mind wearing glasses, don't do in those cases. Hypercritical patients with unrealistic expectation want very sharp vision, especially for near, heavily dependent on intermediate vision or night driving, commercial pilots, truck or taxi drivers, and low myopes also not a very good candidate for multifocals. Then comes the extended depth of focus. That means simply we increase the depth of focus or the range of vision is increased. EDO files offer better intermediate performance and less light scatter there compared to monofocal IOLs and smaller halos than multifocal IOLs. Technics Symphony IOL is the first one to come insert. This IOL has a biconvex wavefront design interior aspheric surface and a posterior achromatic diffractive surface with an eclate design. Achromatic is again very, very important because it takes a lot of aberrations. This is a Technics lens. This is again Zeiss from Zeiss. It's a condition cataract or presbyopic or astigmatism we can use. Wishing to attain spectacle independence for most daily vitreous. Driving frequently is night, sensitive to halos and glare. So these are the different lenses, but the choice you have to make depending on the patient. So there's not say one shoe fit to all. You have to choose the procedure. Of course, refractive lens exchange is one of the procedure, and you have to judiciously considering the patient's requirement and his lifestyle. Thank you.
Hi everyone, good afternoon. I am the last talk of the session. So a lot of the stuff that I was going to speak on has already been covered. So we will not drag and go into the same thing again and again. So basically I'm going to just speak a little bit about the dominance of new technology for implanting multifocal toric IOLs after cataract surgery. And basically to fix presbyopia, which is like a whole new market. Just imagine if everybody after the age of 47 or 48 did not want to wear spectacles anymore and you could offer them a solution. See, the basic issue is that no one wants to grow old anymore. So about a few thousand years ago, they had all these different ages. And they said that after 75, you had to croak. And between 50 and 75, you were no longer productive. And all these things have changed. So basically, times have changed. And no one follows all these ancient rules anymore. Everyone wants an active lifestyle. Old folks want to buy and drive a Lamborghini. Hugh Hefner was an icon for us. So isn't a bifocal implant adequate for cataract surgery or a refractive lens exchange? So when multifocal lenses came out into the market about 20 years ago, they were all bifocal. So nowadays, bifocal lens will not cut it anymore. People will complain that they can only see distance and then they have to hold things up here. Have you ever seen anybody holding a phone up here like this or holding an iPad up here like this? Everyone wants to hold it at intermediate distance, so you need intermediate vision. If you're a pilot, we've operated pilots, if you're a pilot in a cockpit like this, and look where all his switches and readouts are. Everything is at intermediate vision, nothing is at 12 to 14 inches. If you are the surgeon, again, you cannot go 12 inches away from the patient. And if you actually can find a library anymore and you go to browse for books, that's the same situation. So intermediate vision is the key, and which is why I much prefer the new intermediate Zeiss lenses. This is basically my lens of choice for those people that can afford it. It's the 80 Lara, because distance vision is better than the bifocal and trifocal lenses on the market. I was putting the Lisa Tri or the trifocal lens that they produce, but not anymore. So basically, vision at all distances is still the holy grail of cataract surgery. And this is the one that I much prefer to put now, which is the one that I've highlighted there, extended depth of focus IOLs. So in which patient will you put what? So if you have a younger person, 48, 50, 52, 55, I would still put in the 80 Lara because they want very good vision, they want intermediate vision. If you are people who are 70, 75, who haven't made the jump to electronic devices and are still stuck reading books and stuff, then they will still be happier with a Zeiss trifocal lens or any other trifocal lens, because you will get better reading addition, because these lenses have a reading add of about 3.3, while the extended depth of focus lenses are about 2 diopters. As Dr. Vinod Arora was just mentioning, you have to have perfect biometry. There's no excuse for that. If you don't have an IOL master, send them to someone who does, get measurements and then implant the lens. The days of doing the old axial biometry with that probe are dead now. Throw it away. Insist that if the patient wants multifocal lenses, they must have bilateral surgery or surgery within the same week. Otherwise, they are never ever going to be happy. God forbid you operate somebody 46, 47 years old, put in a multi in one eye, and he says that he sees better with the other eye. What are you going to do? You can't take it out and give him his human lens back. What if a patient has cylinder? If cylinder is over 0.75 or 1, it will blur vision, and that quality of vision is unacceptable because patient wanted to be spectacle free in the first place. So we used to use these toric electronic markers like this. You'd set it. You see the timestamp on the photo is 2013. And since then, we are using markerless toric systems like this. So let's have a look at it. So basically, this is basically what we were doing. So this gives you exact 90, 180. You can actually set it to the axis you want. But the confounding factor here is that patient is sitting vertical. Is he exactly at 90 degrees or is he at 88 or 85 degrees? You never know. So marking it perfectly vertical is never really the same thing as using a markerless system like this. So the image comes from the IOL Master 700, goes directly into the Callisto system, where you can decide, and this will have like an overlay like this. So this is the view through the microscope. So even if the patient turns the eye, etc., is not lying perfectly horizontal, it's neither here nor there, it works just fine. So that's a toric lens. You can see the patient's eye moves, you're moving, lens is moving, but eventually you can get it absolutely spot on, and this is what makes the difference. So when to plan mono vision with a trifocal, one eye mono, one eye tri-diff or EDOF lens, just as what Kamal was saying, that he puts in a lens on top of the human lens, a phakic lens, and tries it in one eye. So we have a lot of patients like this where one eye has already been operated earlier with a monofocal. Patient wants to be spectacle free, but is okay wearing glasses sometimes. So you have to explain to them that because they don't have a multifocal lens in the first eye that was operated, it will never be 100% spectacle free, but at least most of the time they will be. If you counsel them yourself, they will understand this. And I've been doing bilateral cataract surgery for the last 20 years or so. And especially with multifocals, this is what I do, where you plan the incision mark beforehand, wash the right eye first with betadine, finish operating, change the machine, drapes, trolley, gloves, gown, everything, rewash the other eye, and then do it. So it's like doing two eyes on separate days for all practical purposes. And this is the last video, which is about 60 seconds. So this is what I do when I'm not doing cataract surgery. So I attended this school recently called the California Superbike School, and they made this little video for me, which I'll just share with you. Is there a jack here? Audio jack? The sound here? No. So there's no sound, you just have to do it without the sound then. So basically you have to have something to do on your day off, otherwise you get bored and you get stale. So if you go ride your bike on the track Saturday, Sunday, you come back to work on Monday, everything works better. So I just thought I'll share this with you. Thank you.
Good afternoon everyone. Dr. Susan couldn't make up for the session, so I'll be talking on the Pearl technique. Corneal inlays are becoming favored modality for the treatment of presbyopia, and it is based on the additive technology, that's what we all know. And the limitation of this the method is it can induce inflammation, corneal haze, and also prevent the nutrition of the underlying structure. So that is where the Pearl technique will help us. It is a small thin donor lenticule which is obtained from the smile lenticule, where we make a small cut of it that is around 1 millimeter. It is inserted in the cornea via a femtosecond pocket. Emmetropic presbyopic patients are the ideal patients for this Pearl technique. The smile procedure is performed with the Visumax femtosecond laser platform. The donor age of the patients whom we have taken are the myopes ranging from 21 to 30 years. The correction ranging between -2.5 to -2.75. So I'll show you the video of the surgical technique. In this, the primary procedure of smile lenticule is extracted by the usual smile technique, where the entire lenticule is taken and out of it 1 millimeter punch is made. It is done with the dermal punch. 1.3, 1.5, 2 millimeter can be taken. And in this procedure, we have done for almost 1 millimeter patients. The smile lenticule incorporated into the center part of the cornea increases the depth of focus and changes the modulation transfer function. Therefore, the near and intermediate vision is best in these patients, even though there is a mild drop in the distant vision. So the preoperative evaluation has to be done for these patients, identifying which patients are ideal. Doing the preoperative evaluation includes the dominant and non-dominant eye evaluation, distant corrected and near corrected visual acuity, and fundus evaluation. You also rule out other comorbid illness of cornea. The initial procedure is to make a hinge flap entry and make a 295 degrees. You take the flap of the lenticule and preserve it in the cornizone. So you can also preserve it if you are going to do in the next day. You have to place it at the right side up, mark the center of your lenticule with the Sinsky hook and the ink. You can also make dots so that it gets inverted in when put inside the pocket. So this is the lenticule. Preoperatively, you mark the center of the pupil, and after you make the hinge, you dissect only the center part of your cornea. It is around 120 microns depth. And you can insert the pearl inlay into the center part of the cornea where you have marked already. It is a 2 days post-operative well-centered lenticule. And it is invisible for a diffuse light illumination. Only it can be seen on high magnification retroillumination. This is the 2 millimeter lenticule for another patient. Intraoperatively, you will not encounter any major complications, and it is very easy to perform. As we all know, the other complications for other techniques where you use a hydrogel for corneal inlays can be haze formation, infection, inflammation. That will not be seen in the biocompatible tissue of the human cornea. This is a 6 months post-operative period of a pearl patient. And you can also do it in pseudophakic eyes. You can combine with phacoemulsification in patients who have the presbyopic age group. This is some of the patients. And you can see in presbyopic refraction after the pearl inlay, there is increase in the central hyperpolate nature of the cornea. And the depth of focus also increases in these patients. And there is improvement in intermediate and near vision. Clinically, the inlay is not visible. But you can use an OCT on the post-operative period. This is a retroillumination for evaluation. All these patients, we have done around 10 patients in the series, and which has been published in Journal of Refractive Surgery. And there has been improvement in intermediate and distant vision. There was no defect in the fields or visual examination of the fundus, and all these patients had independence of glasses for reading, and there was increase in the reading speed, and they're able to do the computer work without any problem with contrast. And the distance near vision reading property was better than the non-operated eye, and the patient was able to read much closer as compared to the non-operated eye. Subject to symptoms like ghost images or dysphotopia or night vision problems were not seen. You can see in the post-operative op scan, there is hyperpolate nature seen in the central 2 millimeter zone of the cornea. And this was maintained for almost 1 year in these patients. This is a spectral domain OCT showing the lenticule in the center. The measurement is around usually 60 to 70 microns of thickness. And as I told, you can combine with other procedures also if you have a refractive surgery or in a pseudophakic eye or patients in phacoemulsification. You can do a phacoemulsification followed by a pearl technique. So this is a patient where pseudophakic eye, after phacoemulsification, the pearl inlay is implanted. You can see the pearl inlay in the cornea, the post-operative period. There have been uses where the smile lenticule has been used in aphakia, hyperopia, and keratoconus. But this novel method of treating this inlay for presbyopia is a newer thing. And we have done few cases where the patients are coming for follow-up, and they have shown a good symptomatic improvement, and they are satisfied with the technique. These are some of the features of pictures of the patients, and this is the table showing the improvement in the near and intermediate vision in these patients. And you can also preserve this pearl inlays doing a cryo technique. Suppose if you want to do it on some other center, you can transport through the media. So the main advantage of the pearl is it is biocompatible. We have not encountered any rejection in these eyes. And we feel that this could be an important alternative for treating presbyopia. Thank you.